Good morning, everyone. Thanks for being here this morning. Thanks to our sponsors at Bloom. Nothing could be more important at a time like this than supply chain efficiency. So thank you for supporting our program today. I'm Matt Shea, and I'm glad to welcome all of you to our final Retail Leadership Series conversation for the year. We've had so many great conversations, and I'm really excited about today's discussion. We have a fantastic guest who is also a member of our board and our executive committee, and from whom I've learned a lot. And those of you that work with boards know sometimes you have directors that really contribute, and other times you've got directors that aren't able to add that much energy to the discussion. And I can tell you that I have learned an enormous amount just in a relatively short time from Patrice, who has been a great member of the board. So Patrice Louvet is our guest, the president and CEO of Ralph Lauren Corporation. I think most of you know, but I'll share a little background because it seems in many ways that Ralph Lauren as a lifestyle brand is ubiquitous and is present in so many ways and has set such a high bar for creating the image and the lifestyle and the aspirations for so many of us. Ralph Lauren's a global leader in design, marketing, distribution of a whole range of premium lifestyle products. And, you know, many of us, some of us maybe think of the apparel side, but it's much more than apparel, of course. It's accessory, home fragrance, hospitality. I've seen actually some amazing home pieces and have some friends that are actually collectors and have some really interesting things. The Ralph Lauren family of brands, of course, is recognizable around the world. Many of us know the Polo brand, but also Ralph Lauren Collection and Purple Label, among others. And to give you a sense of scale, little context, Ralph Lauren Corporation has annual revenues in excess of $6 billion, more than 500 stores around the world, and more than 200,000 employees, all of whom are focused on bringing to life the company's purpose to inspire the dream of a better life for their customers through authenticity and of course, through the trademark timeless style of Ralph Lauren himself and of the brand. Patrice also serves, of course, on the Ralph Lauren Board of Directors, joined the company in 2017 after a very distinguished career of increasing responsibility and high-level positions at Procter & Gamble in a variety of roles around the world. In his current role, he's responsible for driving Ralph Lauren Corporation's Next Great Chapter strategy, which we'll get a chance to talk about a little bit, and for executing and bringing that strategy to life, as well as thinking, as I know Patrice does, from some of our early conversations about delivering value and long-term growth that is sustainable and doing it the right way, creating value for the brand globally, but taking people with you and doing it with the right value, the right mission, and the right purpose. As I mentioned a minute ago, over the course of his career, Patrice has worked at P&G, leading brands in positions around the world, multiple multi-billion dollar brands ranging from Gillette to Pantene to SK-II, and his leadership roles have taken him literally around the world, Europe, Asia, North America, and I, for one, am really glad he's back in North America and close by, right up Interstate 95. He's, of course, based on all that, got a proven track record of growing the brands across diverse distribution channels, from e-commerce to wholesale to retail bricks and mortar stores. And as is critical in a position like this one, he's got incredibly strong talents and abilities in creating partnerships, both with retailers and with iconic fashion houses, for example, among which it would include Gucci and Hugo Boss. So really, really happy to have him. As I said, I have learned an enormous amount, and you really can't help but learn when you're with Patrice, and he's got such a wonderful perspective from all of those experiences and his great insight. I'll just share before I ask him to turn on his camera and join us, I just want to remind everyone, we'll do some Q&A, and so you can submit questions through the Q&A function. I'll try to get to those as we get into the to the conversation. And so with that, I invite Patrice to join the discussion and turn on the camera and the microphone.
Good morning, Matt.
Good morning. So nice to see you. Thank you for taking time to join us for this conversation.
My pleasure to be here, and thank you for all those kind words. And I am thrilled to hear that you're a fan of our home products, and we'll make sure you get to see the full portfolio.
I would love to. I've got a good friend that's got an outstanding, I won't say a covet, but a lovely coffee, big coffee table that sits in front of a big square, sort of 4x4 wood. It's spectacular.
Great.
And so I want to ask, of course, about the last 10 or 11 months. It's the beginning of this year, and sort of how, you know, to share your thoughts of, you know, where we were February 1, what we were thinking about for the year, and where we are now. But I have to ask before that, so all of your global roles, and P&G is an enormous corporation, and you worked across, of course, your last role in beauty, and you built strong partnerships, and then you go to work for an iconic designer, entrepreneur, company founder. And it just strikes me that since Mr. Procter & Gamble aren't around anymore, it's a big difference between working for a company like that and working for Ralph Lauren Corporation. And yet there's so many things that were a perfect fit. And I know you and Ralph were so thrilled at the fit. If you could just for a minute talk about what it was that was intriguing and how you came to Ralph in the first place.
Sure. Well, I spent quite a while at Procter & Gamble, over 25 years, so it was not easy to leave P&G, but I had been contacted by Ralph Lauren, actually almost 10 years ago now. Roger Farah, who's working with Ralph at the time, had reached out, and we had built a nice relationship, and they were looking for a head of international at the time. And things were progressing well. And then Procter & Gamble at the time came back to me and said, we'd like you to run Gillette. And that's such an iconic men's brand that I decided to take that opportunity and stop the conversations with Ralph Lauren. But when things changed at Ralph Lauren a few years ago, they got back in touch with me. And the things that attracted me, Matt, are a few. One is the opportunity to work with someone like Ralph Lauren. There are very few iconic visionaries, leaders, and creators like Ralph. And I thought having the opportunity to spend time with him, learn from him, partner with him was pretty unique. Two, you know, I'm a brand guy, right? I spent most of my time building brands in different categories, as you've called out. And Ralph Lauren is one of those iconic global brands that is a real privilege to work on, with what I saw was a lot of potential outside of North America, a lot of global potential, a lot of digital potential, and an opportunity to continue to evolve how the story of the brand is told. So I was attracted by that. And then Ralph and I spent actually a lot of time together before we both kind of inked the contract, just to get to know each other and make sure that we were on the same page from a cultural standpoint, from a collaboration standpoint. And I find that the Ralph Lauren values, just like the P&G values, really line up very well with the values that matter to me. And now, a little more than 3 years in, I can say that the experience has confirmed that. Yeah. So it's all these drivers, Matt, that have driven me to make the change. And I have to say, a little more than 3 years in, I've been really pleased, and I feel very grateful for having had this opportunity to lead this company with Ralph and to write the next great chapter. That's really the way you referred to it, and that's really the way we think about it. This company is 53 years old. We are working on the next 50 years. And our responsibility as a leadership group right now is to write the next great chapter in that amazing book.
Yeah, and that makes perfect sense. And so with that foundation, alignment on values, and you had, of course, several years to be already in the midst of some of the changes that you want to bring about and thinking to the future. And so we all come through a fairly good 2019 in a lot of ways, a lot of growth, consumers are healthy, and unemployment is down, and we feel like we're poised for continued growth this year. And we all have these plans for 2020, and then we run into this. Were you, because you're a global brand and the relationships and visibility and exposure in other parts of the world, did you sense and learn and experience some of this before maybe some of us in the U.S. really recognized what we were headed for?
Yeah, the canary in the coal mine on this one was actually the situation in China. And we have a good presence in China. It remains a significant growth opportunity for us, but we have a good presence in China. So to some extent, that was the first interaction that we had with the COVID crisis, the impact on our teams, the impact on our stores, the impact on our customers. And so we developed a lot of our approaches that we then expanded in Europe and in North America from our experience in China. Now, you know, the hope in all this, if you look at this China situation now, is China is back to the business situation it was in prior to the crisis. And so I think that gives all of us hope that as we get this virus under control, then we can get back to developing the business, engaging with consumers, building our organization the way we were doing as we went into this crisis.
Yeah, which is really remarkable to think about. Of course, when we sit here today, and you know, so many Americans and so many citizens of the world still facing incredibly dire circumstances, and that's certainly why we know we need more fiscal stimulus and support from governments here in the U.S. and around the world. And yet, it does feel like we can see some light at the end of the tunnel, and we see this positive news with the vaccine and vaccines, and it should seem to position us for a recovery fairly quickly as we get into the new year, hopefully, or at least by the middle of next year and beyond. So as you think back over the 12 months or since the beginning of this year, since February, were there some key moments or milestones for you and the team? You've got a global team, you've 200,000 team members around the world in all these markets and all these stores, and people are closing things, and you've got to pull people out of all of the places in which they're working, and you've got to keep the supply chain running. Everyone's got to go remote. How did that all come together, and what happened from there that you've continued to move forward this year?
You summarized it well. You know, a lot of people have used the term unprecedented to describe this year, and obviously that's certainly been the situation we've dealt with. And I would say, in addition to the COVID crisis, we've obviously had to work through the movements that were initiated by the murder of George Floyd and the spotlight put on social injustice, and then of course all the intensity and anxiety around the presidential election. So it has certainly been an eventful year for us on multiple dimensions. With really no roadmap, right? So this is where, as I kind of think through the key milestones, the first one, Matt, is obviously taking care of the health and safety of our teams. And that was the first thing we had to deal with at the time. And obviously, I'm sure many of the people on this call were faced with a similar challenge with no specific playbook on how to do that. But if we are focused on bringing our purpose to life, which, as you mentioned, is to inspire the dream of a better life, to authenticity and timeless style, and it obviously starts with taking care of our teams and our people. So I think on the fly, we have to develop approaches in terms of what are the safety and health measures we put in our distribution centers, how do we organize ourselves in our headquarters, and ultimately, what do we do in our stores? And, you know, we decided to encourage all of our team members ultimately to work from home, which has proven to be very effective, and I guess we'll see where we go as things reopen. But I'd say that's the first milestone, guided by our purpose, and I think focused on, you know, connecting the dots with outside partners to really make sure we're implementing best in class across the industry. And the NRF actually was quite helpful through that exercise. Second milestone was store closures. And in some parts of the world, store closures were easy. You just followed the government or local authority mandates. In other parts of the world, namely here in the US, the government mandates or the local authority mandates did not come that quickly. And so we had some intense conversation internally between, you know, do we protect the livelihood of our teams in the store? Because obviously the fact that they can work means revenue and their livelihood or their safety, right? And it was a pretty tough dilemma to sort through with some heated conversations inside. And again, on this one, you know, back to our purpose, we decided that we wanted to make sure our teams were safe. And in the environment that just felt so uncertain, we decided to close our stores and live with the consequences from a financial and business standpoint. Third area is cash, right? And cash is obviously lifeblood in general, and particularly lifeblood in these situations where there's hardly any revenue coming in and a lot of cost that we have to deal with. And I have to tell you, probably the most difficult decisions I've had to make in my career has been to furlough a very large part of the company. And I know how painful that's been on our teams. But frankly, given the uncertainty in terms of how long this was going to last, and we wanted to make sure we had sufficient cash flow to navigate this and actually come out stronger, not just kind of stumble out of it.
Yes.
We felt the need to do that. We also, you know, went to the capital markets and raised some significant funding to make sure we had the cash flexibility for however long this was going to last. Our assumption was we need to plan for at least a year to 18 months.
Right.
All right. Fourth milestone I would call out is the pivot needed for digital, mm-hmm. both in terms of how we work, because now all of a sudden, how are we going to approve the next line of products, right? We can no longer touch the fabric. We can no longer engage with the product samples. So an incredibly fast pivot from the team, and I'm very proud of them, towards digital product creation, 3D products, virtual showrooms, and also building the connected retail capabilities, which, you know, we've had a chance to talk about. Buy online pickup. You talked to Sarah about it yesterday. Buy online pickup in store, buy online ship from store, virtual clienteling, digital catalogs, and so on and so forth, which was an exhilarating, intense, and incredibly satisfying phase for the company because, like many of the people I'm sure on this call, we've dramatically accelerated the buildup of our digital capabilities. And then the last thing I would say is, you know, now we are focused on, okay, what does the next 5 years look like? Where do we expect, as we kind of work our way out of this crisis, how do we want to set the company up for success for the next 5 years? So we're going through this work of what are the key growth vectors? What's the organization structure and size that we need? How do we think about our real estate, both our store footprint and our work, you know, our distribution centers, our headquarters, and our brand portfolio? You know, if I step back and I look at how we structured our work over the past, I guess, 12 months now, we talked about, you know, how do we manage the crisis now? How do we prepare for the rebound, which was supposed to be in the summer and, you know, the rebound, and then it closed down again.
Yeah.
And then how do we get ready to win in the new normal with the mindset that says we have to come out of this stronger than we came into it, without being oblivious to the plight that many people have had to deal with. You know, I like the quote that says, never let a good crisis go to waste. And certainly this has been our mindset as we've navigated through this crisis. And candidly, I think today, while we're still, you know, working through it, I think are actually the fundamentals of this company are stronger than they were when we started at the beginning of the year.
Yeah, thank you. That's really helpful. And I think that last bit is sort of like forged in fire. A bit. You're right. You come out of an experience like this, and if you created the right foundational underpinnings and you had the right values and focused on the right priorities, then it does sort of lay everything else bare that you say, okay, everything else was just sort of extraneous. These are the real priorities, and we've strengthened those and we do recover. And I think that listening to you speak that way about, you know, the sort of the phases of this, or Satya Nadella, among others, have said sort of, it's sort of succeed, sustain, survive, sustain, succeed, or there, you know, or rescue and reimagine. But I think you're right. You need to find a way to come out of this and have used this as an experience and an opportunity not to just be where you were, but to be better than where you were. Although it seems in some ways, at least on one of those capabilities you mentioned, one of the milestones on digital, you had a little bit, I mean, clearly your instincts were already that there was an opportunity there since you came on board a little over 3 years ago. That's been one of your real key priorities. And I, if I recall, one of your, if not your first, one of your early hires, I think, was a chief digital officer. So, right. so you were already thinking this way. That must have created some opportunity to be a little bit better prepared, but there's no question to suddenly do everything that you do in a tactile, physical way virtually is not as easy.
Hey, listen, when I came in and we did the assessment with the leadership team in terms of where we needed to put our chips and what we thought the key building blocks were going to be for the future, clearly leading with digital is one of them that we called out and continue to call out today. And you are right that actually my first leadership hire was a chief digital officer, a position that did not exist at the time. We look at digital through three different lenses. The first one is how do we interact and engage with consumers? The second one is how do we transact with consumers? And then the third one is how do we digitize our operations as a company and in the way we connect back to our external partners? Couple illustrations maybe for each one. So how do we interact and engage with consumers? This is all about being where the consumer, our target consumer, mm-hmm. consumes media, is looking for storytelling, right? So it was pretty significant pivot for us more towards the Snapchats of this world, Instagrams of this world, WeChat, Kakao, Line platforms. And we have built an amazing partnership with all of these social media platforms, including Snapchat. And I don't know if you saw, and if not, you can have a little fun after this call. A recent partnership that we did with Snapchat where you can actually dress your Bitmoji, Matt, the truth, the Bitmoji. You can dress your Bitmoji in Ralph Lauren. And in the span of a few weeks, we've actually had more than 13 million people dress their Bitmoji in Ralph Lauren and over 300 million tryouts, which well exceeded, I think, anyone's expectations. It gives you a sense when you're at the right place with the right program and platform that consumers really, really do engage. So that's an area we're going to continue to build and continue to drive. But I look forward to seeing your Bitmoji dressed up in Ralph Lauren gear. Maybe we'll get the whole NRF board doing that. on the transacting with consumers front, you know, we look at this through four vectors. One is RalphLauren.com, which really needs to be our online flagship. And I'll come back to a recent example that I'm quite excited about. The second are the brick and clicks, which, you know, the Macy's.com, for example, which have been very, very effective and very, very successful. Third is pure players. And then the fourth is social commerce, which think Instagram's checkout, think WeChat, which I think are at the very early days, but it's such a frictionless and engaging opportunity and experience for the consumer. I think that's actually going to grow significantly. We recently, you know, mixing brick and mortar and digital have digitized a large number of our flagship stores, such that if you go on our website, you can actually visit and shop from our Rodeo Drive store in Los Angeles, from our Saint-Germain store in Paris, from our Madison Avenue stores in New York. And it's really there for a complete kind of blend of this brick and mortar and digital. And it's been exciting to see the consumer response to that. Mm-hmm. And then on digitizing how we work, you know, we challenge everything with the mindset, with a digital first mindset that says, okay, one, it's 2021, right? So should we be working on this at all? And two, if so, what is the digital way to approach it? So I mentioned a couple of examples earlier on digital product creation, digital showrooms, but everything we're really challenging through that lens, working to apply analytics, beginning to implement artificial intelligence, both in terms of how we provide consumers with better experiences and also how we you know, leverage data to better inform where we put our investments and where we focus on. So it's a journey. I don't think it will ever stop. I do think, though, digital will become like electricity. which is we won't notice it. It'll be everywhere and it'll power everything that we do. You know, today we're all very focused on it. We don't talk about electricity aside from when we get our bill at the end of the month. But I think digital is on its way to becoming electricity for us.
It is. It's just always there. It's like the operating, it's always there in the background. No one thinks about the operating system on it. Just you turn on your technology and it works. You don't think about the OS or whatever's behind us. Well, I would love to talk about the supply chain too. All the brands, your current brand and other brands, and which lend themselves more easily and which do not to a virtual world, but also the supply chain implications. And it's just fascinating to think about doing all this, the 3D design on garments and on apparel pieces, but then bringing it to life, as you just said, for consumers at a time when you can't be in some places, you can't be in other places. I mean, our store in Georgetown, which is not far away. I love all the stores in the US. I'd like to go to the store in Saint-Germain, though. That would be, if I could go somewhere, maybe I want to go to that one. So I guess these are all examples to a certain extent, Patrice, of trends that were already out there that have been pulled forward, that have been accelerated by by the pandemic. So it seems like for those, as we discussed a minute ago, that we're willing to take this crisis and try to find opportunity in it, that there will be real benefits. And so we talked a minute ago, and you referenced the Next Great Chapter plan, which you just recently announced. And I wonder if you could elaborate on that a little bit and talk a little bit about some of the elements of the plan and sort of the vision that you and Ralph and the team are thinking about.
Sure. So the Next Great Chapter plan has five key kind of accelerator vectors as we look to build, to drive growth and value creation on a sustainable basis for the many years to come. And we really look at it through the lens of our five stakeholders, right? So our employees, our consumers, our investors, our partners, and the communities we live in. And we want to make sure that for all five stakeholders, we're delivering unique value that's distinctive and competitive. The five areas that we're focused on map is, the first one is to elevate and energize the brand. I mean, as I mentioned to you, one of the reasons I came to this company is because this amazing, iconic Ralph Lauren brand. And we know we can have continuous opportunities to continue to elevate it, bring different level of energy, bring a new generation of consumers into this brand. So that's the first area of focus with the many different tools that we have available, and we touched on a few of them. Second area is a shift towards direct to consumer. And this business was built on wholesale. And there are some wonderful parts of the wholesale business that, you know, we want to continue to drive. But we do want to pivot towards having a more direct ownership of the consumer experience. And so that guides our focus, our investments, to really make sure we are able to provide a unique experience to the consumer that reflects the standards, the values, and the environment that we see for the brand. And so that's second area of focus for us, is direct to consumer. Third, as I mentioned earlier, is winning in digital continues to be an area. And you know, that's there's been a discussion as to whether we should still call it out or not. And I think we do at this point, at least for the next 5 years. And you know, back to the electricity point, I suspect 5 years from now, we won't need to make it as overt, but we're still early on the journey across the vectors that I mentioned. Fourth area is international expansion, with a deliberate focus on China, where we have a good foothold, where the brand has good traction, but you know, we're very early days on that journey when I compare to many of our peers, particularly our higher luxury peers. And then the fifth area is to develop high potential underrepresented categories in our business today. And we were talking home earlier. Mm-hmm. So think home, think outerwear, think athleisure, think beauty. One of the magics of this brand is it's a lifestyle brand. So we're not kind of pigeonholed into one or two product categories. We actually are able to play across a very wide range of opportunities. And frankly, our challenge is actually more to choose than it is to play, right? Because we can sell you a pair of socks at $10. We can sell you a watch for $100,000, and we range across all of these. So we've singled out a few categories where we want to double down, where we think there's significant value to be created, where the brand resonates, and home and outerwear and beauty are examples of those. So five growth vectors. And then what is really key to us is our role on citizenship and sustainability. And I am convinced that we cannot be successful long-term if we do not lead in this space. So, you know, I think the company is making solid progress on these. We have a clear game plan on it, but I am very clear when I look at the stakeholders I talked about earlier, consumers, employees, investors, communities, partners, that they expect it from us, right? And if we don't make a difference here, if we don't lead in this space, then we will not be successful. So that is an overlay, I would say, on everything I mentioned earlier, that really needs to penetrate every dimension of the company.
Yeah, I think that's right. And I think that's certainly what we hear from our members. And you've been helping us think through that, the whole issue of sustainability and doing this in a responsible way. And that clearly continues to be a real priority. And I think as we come out of this cycle, will be an even greater priority, and will take more of our time and deserves more of our resources and our focus, which we will do with your help, right, and guidance and counsel. We're not open everywhere, of course, in terms of physical locations, but we're some ways coming out of this, although again, it's hard to juxtapose maybe a healthy forecast for the holiday season against the backdrop of so many families facing so many challenges. And I hope we get support and relief soon, and we can get the vaccine distributed and things. And yet, even as we come out of this, there's been so much transformative change in consumer behavior that it seems inevitable some of that behavior will survive beyond the next 6 months or the next year. And if you looked at some of the changes you've seen in consumer behavior over the last year, would you be able to identify certainly the digital engagement pieces? You said, thinking of digital, we all just take it for granted. But how do you think about what changed, both for consumers and for the business community? What change is permanent, and how much of this we just revert back to our old behavior?
That's a great question. I don't know if my crystal ball is any better than your crystal ball, Matt, but I'll tell you what we're working on and what we're assuming.
Yours is better traveled than mine.
The first one is, I think health and safety, which has become an important dimension in consumers' decision process and shopping journey, will remain to varying degrees, but I think it will continue to be a factor in the way consumers behave, even when the vaccine is widely available. I think that's here to stay. Now, for how long, I don't know, but I think that's here to stay, and consumers will be sensitive to that. The second you touched on, I agree with, which is really this whole connected retail experience, right? Listen, my parents at the beginning of this crisis weren't using any apps. They're just outside of Paris, and were certainly not ordering food online. Okay, and now they're incredibly versatile at ordering food and other things online. I don't expect them to go back to their prior habits when all this goes away. So I think all the connected retail capabilities that we've put in place are here to stay. And I think it's a good thing, because generally it's a better experience for the consumer. And it's also a better way for us to engage with the consumer, to tell our story, to build the attachment to the brand. So that's going to stay. And we're certainly working very hard to make sure that we ingrain it in everything that we do. The third area is, I believe that consumers are looking more and more for personalized experiences. And we want to make sure that as we engage with them, we understand them better. And this is where the whole data analytics piece comes into play, so that we can serve them in a way that really meets their needs and their dreams and their expectations as best as possible. So, you know, our ambition is one-to-one marketing, which is that ultimately every consumer has a different experience with Ralph Lauren, still grounded in the core values and executional equities of the brand, but really unique. So personalization would be three. Third, fourth, it's something that really struck me at the beginning of this crisis, is the importance of values and purpose. At the beginning of the crisis, we stopped all brand product communication. We just felt it just wasn't right to be trying to sell product at a time when people were worried about their health and how to make it through this. And we actually shifted towards purpose communication, values, optimism, family, togetherness. And we saw an amazing response from consumers in our data. Purchase intent going up, brand consideration going up, core brand equities going up. And I think at a time where people have been rattled, if people have been worried, I think brands have a very important role to play in providing inspiration, in providing a clarity on the brand's purpose. What impact will it have? What difference will it make beyond just selling product? What are the values the brand wants to drive and represent and care about? And certainly for us, we were going to continue to have that top of mind in the way we engage with consumers. You mentioned authenticity as one of the core Ralph Lauren values. And obviously, you need to put our money where our mouth is when it comes to purpose and values. And that's what we're focused on. But I think that's an important dimension in the consumer thought process and purchase journey. And then finally, as we talked earlier, I think there's some categories that have seen acceleration that will continue post a crisis. Home, I think a lot of people, you know, being in their home, looking around, going, oh, yeah, I got an upgrade. I haven't touched this in 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. I think that will continue. We will see, you know, what happens on the athleisure front, but we're certainly assuming some of that will continue and making sure that we're adjusting to these changes with the consumer behavior. Certainly, you know, throughout this crisis, we've learned the importance of focus on what matters most, resilience and agility. And I think the agility point will continue to be a core area that we can, a core muscle that we continue to build because of this ever-changing world that we operate in.
Yeah, those are all great. I mean, I think that our research has demonstrated, as you said, of your parents, for example, and every single demographic group, regardless of the age group, generation, are all doing much more digitally, much more online in every category. And whether it's consuming news, of course, that way, whether it's food purchases, grocery deliveries, every business. And I think you're right, much of that will sustain beyond this. And the notion, really, the sort of, you talked about the heated discussions internally about, do we protect the livelihood by keeping a store open, or do we think that, because we didn't know anything back then, we didn't know how safe a store environment can be because we didn't know the health and safety protocols then and the idiosyncrasies of the virus, whether it's really contact or airborne or respiratory. And so people made really big decisions based on their core values, on their purpose. So that made a statement. You know, Kevin Johnson at Starbucks said to all their partners, we're going to close our stores, but we're going to keep paying all of you. Mm-hmm. Corey Barry, who was relatively new CEO of Best Buy a year ago, 10 months ago, told me, Matt, you know, we just decided to close our stores. And she said, I thought if I'm going to get fired for something, it's going to be making the right decision for my team. And I think you're right. That expression of purpose and demonstrating your core values when it comes down to it at a really challenging moment, what do you really believe and what do you stand for? Everyone's going to expect that continues. And the health and safety piece. I think none of us will, you know, be a long time until we don't think about, you know, doorknobs and everything else that maybe we didn't used to think about as much. So
this is, I mean, we've talked a lot about how this is actually a leadership moment for the company, right? And when I talk to my team also, just in the way we show up, because 5 years from now, 10 years from now, we and our stakeholders will be telling stories about how the company showed up during this crisis. I'll give you an example on supply chain, which you touched on earlier. You know, we were very clear that we're going to pay our suppliers, right? And yes, we have a cash crunch and we're under pressure, but we are going to pay for our commitments. Mm-hmm. And it would have been easy to say, well, let's just push it out. And, you know, they don't necessarily have that much leverage to force us to pay anyhow. But we looked at this through a longer term lens that says we care about these partnerships. We want to build strategic partnerships with these people. And I want them 5 years from now, 10 years from now to say, you guys at Ralph Lauren, remember, we can count on you, because when the going got tough, you were there.
Yeah, that's so true. And that's such a great note. I know we're getting close to time. I know you've got a full calendar today, and it's a very busy time of year. And so grateful you would join us today. And I think leaving on that note of, you know, people will remember you for the way you behaved and what you did and what you stand for. And you have certainly continued the great tradition of the company and standing for the values that all of us would be proud to be associated with, and continuing to grow the company and take people with you. So, Patrice, thank you so much. I'm so happy to have the chance to visit with you. And thanks for your support as a part of our leadership team and all of the members of your team who are part of the NRF. Thank you so much for all you do to support us.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you for this opportunity. I enjoyed this conversation with you, and thank you for the outstanding job you do as the leader of the NRF.
Thank you. And I want to invite everybody, if you want to see this again, of course, on the YouTube channel. And I want to thank our sponsor, Bloom Global. And I want to invite you to all join us for chapter one of Retail's Big Show starting next month. And we will do this all virtually. We're going to have a great event with lots of terrific content. And Secretary of State, Condoleezza Rice, and many, many CEOs. So I hope you'll all be able to join us for that. And until then, wish you safe, happy holidays. Patrice, thank you again for being part of the conversation.